Welcome to the Double EP, featuring Confessions of a Mad Drag Queen, Barry Bailey, and Gloss Von Waring. Our featured artist of the week, Rockalily Burlesque. And of course, our lovely hosts, Denis de la Violette and Kitty Kamanyeki. Find out all the buzz of Ottawa's entertainment scene. And now it's time for the Double EP.
This morning in the studio, we're very lucky to have with us our director and the leading actor from Confessions of a Mad Drag Queen, which opens at Alumni Hall at Ottawa University this Wednesday, the 21st of August. So if you don't have your tickets yet, make sure you go out and buy some tickets to Confessions of a Mad Drag Queen. So Gloss Von Waring and Barry Daly, welcome to the studio. It's a pleasure to have you here with us this morning.
Thank you so much. It's nice to be here.
So we'll start off, Barry, with you. Who is Barry Daly? Like, what makes you tick? Tell us about your background.
Background. Ottawa's hometown for me. Although I've lived in Montreal for about a year, and I lived London, Ontario. I was there for about 7 years. and Midland, Ontario. I was there for about 3 years. While I was there, I was generally... My background is the trades. I'm currently a custom furniture builder, designer. But when I was in Midland, I was working with a custom boat builder. So that was wooden boats, and we spent 3 weeks in the summer doing the Great Lake Races, which was absolutely wonderful. So it was extraordinary. Sailing into Chicago is just wonderful. I really enjoyed that. So that's part of it there. And I started getting involved in theater in Midland, Ontario as well. And so that was community theater again, and that's where it all started. So whenever I moved back home to Ottawa, I started with Orpheus and eventually moved over to Ottawa Little Theater, stuff like that.
Awesome.
Yeah.
Excellent. Now, Klaus, you have an interesting background as well. You have a, I believe it's a Dutch name. Mm-hmm. Your name is Dutch. Mm-hmm. Now, and you're also a very accomplished painter. I did a little bit of research, and you have some beautiful works. What is your background? Where do you come from?
Well, as you say, I was born in the Netherlands right after the war, and my family came to Canada when I was six. And so I grew up mostly in Kingston and went to Queens and stayed in Kingston until fairly recently. Well, that is to say, now, 20 years ago seems fairly recently. I was always torn between physics, which is what I started studying, and the arts. So what actually happened was I started studying physics and I was in a play at Queens. And you know how it goes. Well, I didn't do too well. It kind of distracted me from that. So I ended up doing my degree in English and became an English teacher for a little while. But as I said, really the interest was in the arts. I would have loved to do theater, but I didn't see how that was going to happen, and I knew I was good skillfully at drawing and painting, so I just, that was sort of where I headed, and had a reasonable career going as an artist and teaching part-time art at the community college. I went from a few years of English teaching into that, and at St. Lawrence College in Kingston. But, you know, it's impossible to make a living in the arts. Mm-hmm. Did you know that?
Mm-hmm. Yes.
Yeah.
Well.
So I found myself with a family and kids, and you know how it goes. And so I went back and did computing science as a master's. Remember the physics and the math?
Mm-hmm.
So then I ended up at Nortel, like so many people. And during that time, I had no time for any theater stuff, really, or any art stuff, except that I sang in the chorus of the Savoy shows in Ottawa. So that was my introduction to, and one Orpheus show where I had a role, and that was when I realized I can't do this again and work.
And that was the first show that we had worked on together.
Oklahoma. Oh. It was earlier, we did Fiddler on the Roof.
Oliver.
Oliver, that's right.
Yes, Oliver.
Yes, that's where we met.
Yeah.
He was Fagin.
I was Fagin.
And I was Bill Sykes.
Yeah.
Nice.
And
so you guys have known each other a long time. Yes.
That was 2005.
Yeah, it was definitely after Nortel. Yeah. Collapsed and I was liberated.
Yeah.
Free to pursue your dream, was it?
Yeah. So, yes, but...
So, I understand that you've worked with a number of theater companies over the years in Ottawa. How would you say, have you noticed really a difference in the theater community since you've started?
Well, there has been an explosion in theater in the city in the last number of years. I only became involved around 2000. Other than that, I had done the musicals a bit. But you know, the rise of the fringe, it's become bigger and bigger, and there are new companies, Plosive and so on, community theaters, semi-professional companies. So there is that almost renaissance of theater in Ottawa. Mm-hmm.
Which is great for all of us to, you know, to be able to get work and to be able to involved in.
Actually, mostly just to be involved in it. I mean, I've noticed something that I really enjoy about the theater community is play after play, each play is a stepping stone to your next play. But it's the people that you're working with, and in their next production, you go and see their production, and it's improvements. You see people constantly improving, and that's mm-hmm. just so good for the community. Mm-hmm. You know, it helps. It's the base of the community, so that's really enjoyable for me.
Yeah, and it's certainly a great starting point for a lot of young actors in Ottawa. There was a time I'm sure we all remember when there were just a limited number of theatrical productions happening in Ottawa.
Yeah,
and now with all of the other opportunities that are out there now, there's certainly a great training ground for a lot of new talent.
Absolutely.
That hopes to get into
Absolutely.
The theater.
Absolutely.
Later on.
Yeah.
So now Barry, you also have. An interesting, I mean, Klaus studied physics, he did some English, he worked for Nortel. I mean, you know, this is, you know, quite a meandering path to where you are today. And Barry, now, you're a very, very renowned cabinet maker, I understand.
I don't know if I'd use very renowned.
Well, I was looking for the right adjectives here, but apparently you're a fabulous cabinet maker is what I hear.
I don't know about that.
Gosh. I've seen his work, it's very good.
Yeah, thank you very much.
Now, how did that come about?
Okay, well, I suppose it all started with boat building. You know, boat building has, it's interesting structure. And I worked with, and it's fine to mention names, Alfred Gruber. I worked with Alfred Gruber, who was probably one of the better known cabinet makers in the city. And so I worked there for 16 years. So that's a good history. Everything that we did there was designer work. So you take 16 years of seeing these fabulous designs, and what is interesting there, I think, is whenever you build it in the shop, the structure was that you had your bench. I was a cabinet maker with my bench. I got the drawings. I built the project. Then you take that to the house, to the home of the client. And then you can stand back and say, okay, this works, or stand back and say, this doesn't work, or I would change this and I would change that. That's just what designers do. So that's the lessons I learned. You know, and so I've been self-employed since about 2000. And working with a couple of designers, and built some fabulous projects. I think I quite like them very much. And, you know, just trying to be bold with every project.
And I guess it's a great outlet for you, because we all understand the stresses and pressures of performing, especially with the project you're doing now with Confessions. So I guess it's a great way for you to sort of tune out a bit and maybe concentrate on something else.
Actually, what is amazing is how many doctors and lawyers want to work with their hands. They all they need a hobby. They need to do something with their hands. So, you know, to watch somebody like me building this thing in their house, and wow, you know, and they just want to help, they want to learn something new, you know. So that's really kind of fun.
Good for you.
That's
good
great.
For you. It's great to have an outlet.
Oh yes, mm-hmm. Yeah.
So, what drew you to your role in Confessions of a Mad Drag Queen? I mean, it's very difficult, obviously, for an actor to choose to do something like that, because there's, I mean, I'm sure there's a lot of adversity and whatnot towards drag queens in general, unfortunately. I could imagine it being very difficult. What made you want to be this character?
She's a drag queen. It's character study. That's fascinating.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and there aren't any negative positions that I have on that. She's a fascinating character. Mm-hmm. And it all starts with the writing. Everything always starts with the writing. So he'd written, David Blue had written a sympathetic character with some problems. Mm-hmm. And you just try to put all that together in the stage production. So, you know, that's fascinating right there. Mm-hmm.
So despite the fact that she's a drag queen, it's more of a character development, whether it's a
man
or a woman.
Well, for me, it really is. You know, you look at what's written on the page and you try to bring some life to that. So I think for me, everything begins with the character, and that's where all of the study begins, mm-hmm. what is on the page.
Mm-hmm. So Klaus, having read the script when we first met, actually, mm-hmm. what when you first read the script, what did you feel were going to be your greatest challenges in directing this production?
Well, the biggest challenge, without question, was casting, right? Because Miranda is such a big character, such an interesting character with so many facets to her personality, and that what you need is an actor with a tremendous range, and you need somebody who can fill the stage. Fortunately, I knew one or two. and fortunately, we had Barry. So it would have been very difficult to do otherwise. Mm. This is not a play you can do with just anybody, right? Mm. And the cast. And John Collins was perfect for the other character.
John just blows me away. He's just wonderful for the part. I just love what he's doing. Yeah.
And again, somebody that I've known just about as long as I've known Barry.
Yeah, and this is my first opportunity to work with John, and I'm really happy about that.
I've never directed either of these guys. I've acted with Barry, and I've worked in other capacities with John before, but this is a real treat. Hmm. So another challenge, of course, is this is a two-hander. There are only two actors on stage, and for much of the play, the one doing all the talking is Mr. Barry here, and so there's the challenge of making that interesting to the audience all the way through. I always liken a play to a piece of music. You can't just do it all on one level. At this, you know, you've got to have movements. You got to have there are areas where something comes up, something goes down, and
it gets monotonous.
That's right.
You lose interest.
That's right. And even with music, you find an album of music usually has like 12 songs on a side. I'm showing my age when albums had sides. Mm-hmm. But anyway, so and that's because it's a new start all the time. So the challenge is, how do you do that when one person is talking for hours? Well, not hours, but you know what I mean.
Almost.
To you, it feels like that.
It feels like it's
and so that means you always have to be making new beginnings, just like you start a new song and that sort of thing. And so that's a challenge, but it's also what makes it interesting, mm-hmm. right? Because what's the fun of doing it if it's too easy, right?
Mm-hmm. True.
And so those were the main challenges: casting and then making it interesting. Mm-hmm.
So what made you want to do this play specifically? I mean, I'm sure there were other options of things that you could have done, and you've chosen this one. Was there a particular reason that you chose it?
Well, it was reading the script. The first thing was the character of Miranda that we've been talking about. She's mm-hmm. so fascinating. She's so big and you know, with all these conflicting directions she's going in. A person with... She's not bound by any convention. She might do anything, you know. Mm-hmm. And then there's, you know, there's she's entertaining and funny, but at the same time there's a tragic and sad past. She's, you know, she's struggling with her own sense of reality. So it's very, very interesting, mm-hmm. right? So it was that character more than anything else, and then the challenge that we talked about,
right?
You know,
Yeah, so what, now the one that we haven't discussed yet is basically what the story, what the play is all about. Now, Barry, maybe you want to, as the lead character, tell us what this play is all about. It's about Miranda.
Without divulging too much information.
Without divulging too much information.
No, give away the plot.
Yes. Okay, well, I think we can say that Miranda has been in prison for the past 25 years thereabouts. We think we're placing her out of prison for about the past 6 months. So she's just sort of getting her life back together again. She has, this gentleman comes to her door. She is about to be interviewed on her past life. And Miranda's delusion is that her life has been extraordinary, huge, and she has been a central figure in this community. And then whenever the interview begins, it's really about her past, an incident that happened in her past. And that's what they want to focus on, what this interviewer wants to focus on, which is a little bit upsetting for her because she doesn't really want to talk about that. Mm-hmm. Her life is much bigger than all of that. Mm-hmm. So it's starting from there, then having to delve into what actually happened in the past and things that she has to face that she doesn't necessarily want to face.
So it's a journey for her. She has to come to terms. It's like any kind of therapy. Once you talk about it, it's out there and you have to deal with
it. It's out there.
So the author, the visitor, forces her to actually relive those events and maybe see them in a different way.
As she recalls them.
Mm. Mm-hmm. And that's selective another, memory another is a very powerful
memory.
Thing, isn't it?
Yeah. You know, it's another interesting thing about Miranda and what world she's living in.
Exactly. You know. And that leads me to my next question. I was going to ask, as an actor, having to relive or wanting to relive someone else's life, relive some of the tragic events in their lives, were there any lessons learned by you as an individual by journeying with Miranda into her madness, into her delusion? Is there something that you as an individual could relate to in portraying this character? I'm kind of putting you on the spot here.
Yeah, I'm not sure that I know that.
Mm-hmm.
Something that I can relate to as an individual. You know,
All right, let me rephrase it. By having lived Miranda during this last couple of months of rehearsal and now about to be live in front of an audience, having discovered her character, what would you say is her greatest flaw? What would you say is also her greatest quality? What is it about her life that she has failed in? Does that make any sense?
She has skipped through fantasy on a daily basis, and her life is completely fantasy. She's never really stopped at reality. It's always been bigger than life for her. And maybe that was her largest flaw, that she just never settled into reality at all. Mm-hmm. It's always been fantasy and what was never really there. I think that's
that's what I'm going for, and also her greatest quality. What quality allows her to sort of rise above all of this and pretend like, you know, the delusion of the past.
Her greatest quality: she has nice shoes.
That's a great answer. That's
fashion.
A great answer. That is great. Absolutely. So how are you feeling about opening on Wednesday?
Oh, excited and scared. Everything is scary and exciting. Oh God.
Yes. Hey, Klaus, how are you feeling?
Well, it gets. I'm sort of at the stage where I don't have much to do anymore. About a week ago, we reached the point where I said, okay, you know, the actors know exactly what they're supposed to do, so it's just a matter of practicing it. And so now there's some technical stuff and management stuff and things are now under control. Consequently, my days are now filled with empty nervousness.
Just waiting.
Just waiting.
Yeah.
Just waiting for an audience.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Exactly,
yeah.
And that'll be a whole different level, as we
it
all
will.
Know.
Yes.
Once the audience comes in, and your whole performance will adjust to the reactions you get.
Yeah.
So,
yeah.
I'm really looking forward to opening night.
Definitely.
And it's gonna be very exciting. So, well, gentlemen, I know you've put a lot of work into this play. Mm-hmm. I know Barry, it's been quite a slog for you as far as script and everything. But it's been wonderful to watch you in rehearsal and to watch your development and watch Miranda come to life. And it's also been interesting to watch Klaus's reaction to your work, because as a director, you're kind of like a father to this whole production, and to watch him sit back and smile when you're performing is really reassuring.
Yeah.
I really look forward to it. It's going to be a very exciting production. So, but I want to also thank you for coming in today.
Yes, thank you.
It's been great to have you here, and I know how busy you are, mm-hmm. and I know you open in a couple of days, so I want to thank you once again for taking the time to come in and talk to us here at the EEP. Now, for all of our audience members, just a reminder, this is Confessions of a Mad Drag Queen, which opens on Wednesday the 21st. Showtimes are 8 o'clock, and it's on Wednesday, Thursday, Friday, Saturday nights at Alumni Hall at Ottawa U. Tickets are $25. They're available either online. You simply go to the website for the theater production company, which is Toto Too Theatre, so that's toto2.ca. Or they're also available at the door. Or you can purchase them at Venus Envy, After Stonewall, and at Wilds, all in downtown Ottawa. And like that, so buy your tickets. Come on out. It's a great show. Barry and John do a great job. Klaus, congratulations. It's going to be a fabulous production. And we just want to say thank you for coming in.
Thank you so much.
Absolutely. So stand by next. We're going to be having our featured artist of the week. And don't forget, we also have our contest coming up. And speaking of contest, we always base our contest question on our special guest. And this week, it's Confessions of a Mad Drag Queen and the cast of. And our question to you is, who is the author of Confessions of a Mad Drag Queen? And where do they send their answers?
You can send your answers into contest at mjmepics.com.
So send your answers. The first person to answer the question correctly wins themselves four tickets to our production. Once again, August 21st to the 25th, or 21st to the 24th, actually, at Alumni Hall at Ottawa University. So once again, gentlemen, Barry Daly, Klaus von Waring, thank you very much for coming in.
Thank you.
Thank you.
So this week's featured artists are Rhapsody Blue and Helvetica Bold, both from Rockalily Burlesque. Hello, ladies.
Hi.
Good morning.
Good morning.
How are you this morning? We're doing all right?
Coffee.
Coffee is good, definitely. So we'll just start off. What are your guys' backgrounds? I guess we'll start with Rhapsody. What kind of got you into burlesque? What made you interested in doing this as at least a part-time, if not full-time career?
Well, in a nutshell, Helvetica got me into burlesque.
Mm-hmm. Sorry.
so this is all her fault. I had been a fan before I was a performer. Had been going to burlesque shows locally, following performers on Twitter, that kind of thing. And when Rockalily decided to do a fundraiser for breast cancer research called Burlesque Idol, with the intent to get some amateurs on the stage, I decided, what the heck? Why not? And was instantly addicted.
And it's been happy sailing ever since?
Yeah, that was nearly 4 years ago.
And is that how the two of you met?
I think we're nerdy internet friends.
Nice.
Ah, one of those kind of things.
What sort of nerdy things did you guys get into before meeting in person?
Mostly social media.
Yeah, I think we knew each other mostly on Twitter before meeting in person.
Okay.
But we have a few overlapping interests.
Mm. Cool.
Now, let me get this right. Rockalily, you guys are the founders, or how? Obviously, I don't know much about Rockalily, so yeah. Why don't you tell us a little bit about Rockalily Burlesque?
I'll let Helvetica take that one.
Okay. I am the co-founder and last remaining original member, actually, of Rockalily Burlesque. We started, the idea was actually formulated in 2006 on my 20th birthday, and early in 2007 we started performing. It was a large group of local women, and the idea was actually a man's idea, big surprise, but he was smart enough to let the women run with it. The burlesque community in Ottawa has just been kind of growing and snowballing organically ever since.
So it's going very well, obviously.
It has been, yeah. I'm really proud of what everyone's doing and how many different things there are. And Rockalily's really stayed true to some of our original mandates and intentions, like being a little bit more feminist, a little bit more politically charged, and all about art and body acceptance. Because some other performers are a lot more about being sexy and pretty, and that's great. I love it, but that's not what I want to do. And most of the girls that we work with are very cool and do things for their own reasons and are kind of crazy art people.
That's awesome. And what got you into burlesque?
Well, it was my friend Tyler who on my 20th birthday told me that we should start a burlesque troupe and I should be a burlesque performer. At the time I was working as a writer and I was like, you're crazy. That's like the opposite of what I do. And a few drinks later, it sounded like a good idea.
As many things will after a few drinks, absolutely. Well, tell us, because you talked about the different styles, different girls. For our audience who's not familiar with burlesque, and for us as well, what is burlesque all about? Can you define what burlesque is?
Burlesque is, and this is actually a question that's often discussed within the industry, there is no clear consensus, especially when it comes to certain hallmarks of the industry. You know, what boxes do you have to check in order to categorize yourself as a burlesque performer? Mm-hmm. But it's mostly distinguished by an aesthetic of tease, a certain flamboyancy. Has its roots in like the vaudeville theaters in Paris, New Orleans, in LA, and other cities around the time of the turn of the century. That is to say, the 1900s, considering we have now turned two centuries, the other century. but it's very much about sort of the marriage of sexuality with theatricality.
Mm-hmm. Because there are a lot of misconceptions about burlesque. I mean, you know, to the average person, when you mention burlesque, they immediately go to the far side or the dark side and think, okay, well, this is basically, you know, women on stage taking their clothes off. But there's a real art form to what you do. I mean, based on how you look today, this is, you know, there's obviously a lot of work that goes into not only your acts themselves, but, you know, your hair, your dresses. You guys look amazing.
I woke up like this. I don't know what you're talking
about.
It's effortless, I'm sure. But there's a whole art form, and how do you go beyond with your audiences? How do you when people ask you what you do, for example, and you say, "Well, I work in burlesque," how do you feel about that whole misconception that's out there, and how do you deal with it?
Well, I always say that it's important to remember that no one burlesque performer is representative of the entire industry. Mm-hmm. So people can have a certain idea that I might consider a misconception, but it's not necessarily unfounded. Mm-hmm. So like if somebody thinks, you know, burlesque is just girls getting up on stage in a corset and thigh highs stripping, I would consider that perhaps a misrepresentation. However, there are girls for whom that is true. Mm-hmm. I generally say that burlesque is stripping's older sister, the one who ran away to Broadway.
the artiste.
Yes. Yeah. So there is an element of sexuality. There are almost all burlesque performers who consider themselves such do an element of stripping, or peeling, as we like to call
it.
That's
nice, peeling.
But there are things that distinguish it from something you'd see in a conventional strip club. Things like there is not the same degree of nudity. We usually just go down to no more than panties and pasties. You usually don't see things like nipple tassels and ass tassels in the strip club, but we do a lot of that. But for the most part, it's the aesthetic. It's the aesthetic and the general tone. And as Helvetica mentioned, most burlesque acts are at least going for a certain theme or making an argument. There is a story to it or a certain, sometimes a political message, sometimes an ethical message. Acts have purpose in and of themselves, like as a unit, as opposed to simply being to titillate the audience.
So there's, from what I've seen from our research, there's an actual scenario. There's a beginning, a middle, and an end. There's a story being told.
Like a short
or
a play.
Yeah, it's like a mini play, complete with costumes, complete with effects. And it's certainly a lot more interesting than, for example, your average strip bar in like you're saying, in any of the major cities, where it's just about, you know, getting down to the nitty-gritty, as we can, if we could call it that, and that's it.
And we have a lot of respect for women who work in strip clubs and sex workers and so forth, because we are really very much their natural allies, because what we do is, you know, not exactly the same, but at the same time, it's very much along the same line of art form. In fact, there are women in the industry who have worked in multiple overlapping intersections of that those different worlds. So we have a lot of respect for them, but it's not exactly the same thing. I don't know if you could say that better than I.
I think there's definitely some strong differentiating factors between what we do and what goes on in strip clubs. And I can say that with confidence, having worked in a strip club.
Oh, really? Yeah.
But, I mean, we're definitely allies to sex workers and strippers. And, you know, they make more money than we do. We have more glitter.
It's, you know, yeah.
We're all friends.
We're all friends. There's obviously a bond or a feeling of community with the other levels of performance, mm-hmm. let's call it, at that level. So that's a good thing. Obviously, you have a lot of support there.
Yeah, burlesque performers, in a way, serve as the bridge between like the industry that you'll see in a conventional strip club and the theater industry, the music industry, because we perform a lot with local musicians, comedians, things like that. So
I consider us to be a very lowbrow form of theater.
Yes.
Personally.
Okay.
I have argued with other burlesque performers who said, no, we're highbrow. Look at how amazing what we do is. And I say, you know what? We make dick jokes and spin tassels. I think that's lowbrow, but I think there's definitely a place for lowbrow entertainment.
Well, the fact that you could do both, uh-huh. I mean, is obviously able to appeal to a wide array of people out there. But lowbrow, highbrow, I just think it's a wonderful form of, let's call it theater, a wonderful form of performing. And I think you're very talented to be able to combine both, mm-hmm. because you definitely take risks on stage that the average actor who does conventional theater may not be willing to or comfortable doing. So, mm-hmm. so congratulations on being able to cross all those. You know, perceived
those
boundaries.
Bridges.
Good for you. Yeah. Absolutely.
Speaking of the wide range of your audience, who comes to see burlesque shows in general? Like, how would you split the demographic?
Well, every troupe varies because every troupe has a different sort of product that they, you know, present to an audience. The audience that they pull is a little bit different. Rockalily, I would say the majority of their fans are women, queer or straight, mm-hmm. Which is not to say that we don't have a substantial following of men, but but because I think of the comedy that certain performers, especially Helvetica, bring to the stage, and the body positivity, the commitment to a certain kind of aesthetic, women naturally gravitate to that because they want to see the costumes, and they want to see girls who look like them doing things that they wouldn't necessarily see themselves doing.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
But yeah, I would say we have about half our fans are women.
At least.
We have a substantial following in the local queer community, but that's simply because we make a point of doing a lot of work with that community. Mm-hmm. I would say that's more about the choices we make professionally than necessarily our performance style.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. Now, you have a quite a varied background as far as your skill sets are concerned, and I understand that you incorporate a lot of these in your acts. Like, for example, you do firework.
I do.
Now, tell us a little bit about that.
Well, I got into the fire artistry simply because I needed a gimmick, really.
Okay.
The burlesque industry in the city is quite full. There are seven troupes.
Oh my!
Seven?
Seven or eight?
Seven or eight?
Yeah.
Eight if you count the Mansfield brothers.
And we do. We like them.
Yes, we do like them very much. With so many burlesque performers, you really need to have something that you can distinguish yourself by. And I'm by no means the only burlesque performer who does fire. The Sin Sisters as well have some fire performers.
The Sin Sisters?
Yes, the Sin Sisters.
Mm-hmm. That is an attractive name.
We also like them.
They're quite pleasant.
Yes. Yeah. They have two performers who occasionally use fire. So I'm not necessarily unique in that respect, but I'm the only one locally who does any fire breathing. I would say I do fire a little more often than some of the other performers, as long as I can get away with it, basically.
As long as you meet all the codes.
Yes.
This is Ottawa, after all. Yes.
It is sometimes difficult to find venues where, because I am insured, I'm, you know, professional, but it can be difficult to find venues that have the necessary, you know, ceiling height, for example.
Mm-hmm. There was one venue that allowed us to do fire for a few years, actually, and someone on one of their hip hop nights accidentally started a fire, and now we're not allowed to anymore.
Oh, that's sad.
So you have to suffer. Yeah. Now, Helvetica, what skill set do you bring? I mean, I know that all of your acts are, every burlesque performer brings their own cachet to their performance piece. Now, what do you bring to the to your performance?
I would be, I suppose, your stereotypical funny fat girl.
Okay.
And my actual background is in marketing and copywriting and event management. So it's really strange for me to say that I draw from that to my performance, but I do a lot of production and behind the scenes. So I'm often the one, I'm the man behind the curtain, hiding, pulling the strings and making things happen. So that's kind of where my skill set intersects with burlesque. But personally, I have a strong interest in political activism and socioeconomic equality and queer GLBTQ rights. So I try to have a little bit of a message in everything I do. And most recently, I've actually put on a lot of weight in the past couple of years, and I got into this global fat acceptance movement. And it's become really powerful. There's so many women that come to the shows just to see me because they're like, you look like me. This is amazing. And as much as it's a hurdle for me to be like, ugh, I don't like my body sometimes, I don't want to do this, when women are empowered by that and they feel better about themselves, it's really worth it. So
you're approaching this from a lot of different angles, from a sociopolitical platform or way of looking at things to a personal image direction. So what you do is not only your art form, but it also has a message behind it, which is really great. I mean, again, that differentiates you from, you know, your Friday night peeler, let's call them. you know, where maybe the message is not that important. It's more of a job as opposed to being involved in it personally.
Mm-hmm. So I understand that we have a clip to show our viewers of each of you. Did you guys want to set that up? What are we about to see here?
The clip I chose to share was actually from an event a few years ago, last year perhaps, called Strip Cheese, which was an actual collective event run by the entirety of the burlesque scene, championed by the Ottawa Burlesque Playground, which is a little overlapping scene. It got me doing a sort of traditionally inspired but also fire-influenced number. My costume is quite traditional, with the thigh highs, with the stockings, the garters, the corset, things like that. However, the music choice, I used Rock You Like a Hurricane by the Scorpions.
That's awesome.
Is not traditional. So I try to do a lot of the melding of different styles. So if I'm doing a traditional aesthetic, I use non-traditional music or something like that.
Okay, and Helvetica?
My clip is from a show I did in Toronto last summer. It's one of the monthly series Reveal Me at the Rivoli, and this clip is of me doing Fat Bottom Girls by Queen, and it's a love story about a girl in a cake.
That's awesome.
All
so
right.
Why don't we cut to that then?
Thank you.
Well, thank you very much. That was great.
That was amazing.
Great clips. Thank you so much for bringing those in. I mean, this is where we really see the artistry in what you do. Now, going back to something you said earlier, Helvetica, about how it's empowering for you being part of this, how did you call it, the movement for...
The body positivity, fat acceptance.
The fat acceptance movement.
There's many words for it.
But being part of this movement and for it to be a part of what you do now, it would be interesting that you should choose a song called Fat Bottom Girls based on... So you're really kind of putting it out there. So your message is really... you're really sticking to your message is what I'm saying. Now, do you do a lot of themes based on body awareness, or do you choose different themes?
I definitely choose different themes. There are some plus size performers who rely on being plus size as their gimmick, and I find it super entertaining at first, and then I get quite tired of it. It's like, okay, we get it. You're fat. You're awesome. What else can you do? Mm-hmm. So although I do like to incorporate it, I try to do multiple things and not rely on it as my gimmick.
So you're not a one-shot deal. It's not just about your body image. It's about so much more that you bring to your performance piece. Mm-hmm. Excellent.
And Rhapsody, obviously, like you were saying, you chose a very traditional look, but a very untraditional song to do. And you said that you do that quite often where you'll mismatch. Now, when you did this performance, did it inspire you to do anything different than you normally do? Was it a new, like a sort of a anything new that you brought to the stage at that point that you continued to use? What kind of feedback did you get, I guess, from doing that performance?
Well, that performance actually represents sort of a transition point in my personal style, aesthetically speaking, that I was very, when I first got into the scene, was very neo-burlesque, lots of really super saturated colors. I wore a lot of pink, a lot of neon. And that performance, which was, I guess, a year ago or so, represented a transition point for me into a more big band circus kind of aesthetic. The music, of course, not so much, but these days I find myself, especially with the fire, trying to incorporate a little more like sideshow circus style into my performances.
Cool.
Excellent. Now, you do a lot of fundraisers. You've raised a lot of money. You and, the whole burlesque community has raised a lot of money for some very good causes, for cancer, for what other causes are you involved in? The Pride, I think you raised money for the Pride Committee. Now, I understand that you have a couple of really interesting, and what I like about this whole genre of performance is the really cool names, not only your names, but you mentioned the Reveal Yourself.
The one in Toronto, Reveal Me at the Rivoli.
Reveal Me at the Rivoli, and all these kind of names. Now, I'm looking at my notes here, and for example, you have a strip spelling bee happening very soon as a fundraiser, and on Halloween, you have an event, you're involved in an event called Zombie Strippers. Now, tell us a little bit about this strip spelling bee. How does this work?
The strip spelling bee is an offshoot of an event that was founded in Toronto.
Montreal. He does them in Toronto as well, though.
Okay. Well, anyway, so I should say, not our idea, however. We have got permission to have one in Ottawa, and we're raising money for PTS.
Which is Pink Triangle Services,
yes.
Which helps out the gay community.
Yes. It's going to be a fun event that's going to get a mishmash of experienced peelers and amateurs and local community members up on stage to show off their brain power and their booties.
Oh, nice. Okay.
And so, go ahead, please.
So is this open to anyone? First of all, when is it happening?
It's happening on the 22nd.
Yep. August 22nd.
August 22nd at Babylon.
Okay.
Yeah. We're no longer accepting spellers. However, the event is open to everyone who wants to come and see people spell some very difficult and very lascivious words.
So basically you sign
That's
up to be a...
That's one of the words.
Is it really?
Yeah, lascivious is one of the words.
So study up.
So basically what you would do is you would sign up to be a competitor.
Mm-hmm.
And you would be given a word to spell, like in the normal spelling bees. And if you don't spell it properly, then you...
Strip off one-third of your clothing.
One-third of your clothing.
Mm-hmm.
I see. So you have to wear like three pairs of socks and three pairs of underwear.
Well, we're giving people the chance to actually execute like a striptease and like Helvetica is hosting and I'm going to be refereeing or assessing the strip teases. Mm-hmm. And if we did one article of clothing at a time, not only would the event take forever, it doesn't give people the chance to actually show off what they can do. Like an actual, and to execute an actual strip tease, you need to take off more than like a glove.
Yeah. Okay.
At least two gloves.
So what you're basically asking them to do is not only take off a piece of clothing, but actually perform for them. Oh, brilliant.
That's great.
That is great. Now, this zombie strippers for Halloween.
Yeah.
Now, that's interesting. I think I'm going to get tickets for that. How does that work, Helvetica?
I promise zombies were still in vogue when we started this show. It's an annual event. This year is fifth annual zombie strippers this year, and the idea is zombies doing burlesque.
Which is quite interesting.
Yeah. Some of the girls take on the character of a zombie, and they're really slow and sluggish and try to eat audience members' heads. And some are just dressed as zombies, or some are running from zombies, or zombie hunters. And because we've been doing it so long, we started to incorporate the other typical Halloween monsters and serial killers and villains. So it's a horror show. It's along the lines of gorlesque, which is kind of a subgenre of burlesque that you see.
Gorlesque. There's another catchy word. That's brilliant. Now, when and where is this happening?
October 31st, Halloween night at Babylon Nightclub.
At Babylon.
Yeah.
So Babylon seems to be a popular venue with the burlesque crowd, or is this where you do
a lot
of shows?
Well, with us, Babylon has been very good to our troupe, so we tend to perform there. Also, the venue is accessible to people who are mobility impaired or in a wheelchair.
Excellent.
And we try as often as possible to make a point of having our shows be accessible as possible.
Okay.
That's awesome.
You'd actually be surprised how difficult that is.
Yeah, locally. A lot of venues with stairs.
Yeah. Well, I guess it's because they transform all the old buildings into venues, and of course they're not equipped, and they don't want to maybe spend the money to make them compatible.
And in some cases, it's not even possible. Like, for example, the Rainbow. Like, the venue is upstairs.
That's it.
What you gonna do?
Yeah, exactly.
You get a lot as well that are accessible to get in, but the washrooms are up or downstairs.
Oh, I see.
There is a reason we perform at Babylon a lot. They also have a very robust backstage area, which not all venues can offer.
Now, how many fundraisers would you say you guys put on in a year on average?
Four, five?
Just under half a dozen.
Yeah.
We've got we sometimes do sequels to our fundraisers as well. On September 23rd? I don't know. Mid-September, Titties for Kitties 2.
September 20th. September 20th.
Safe Hots. That was?
September 20th is Titties for Kitties 2, which is a sequel to a fundraiser that we did for local animal rescue and shelter organizations.
That's awesome.
I love that. Titties for Kitties. I mean, that's brilliant.
That's pretty fun.
Now, burlesque has really come up in the world. When we were talking earlier, you'd mentioned the fact that there's an actual, I think it's a worldwide pageant called Miss Exotic World.
Yes.
Miss Exotic World. So tell us a little bit about that.
Well, most festivals have pageants. So, like, different cities have their own burlesque festivals, of which Ottawa is going to get one.
Yay!
That's awesome.
However, the Miss Exotic World pageant is sort of like the burlesque Grand Prix.
Okay.
It is...
Start your engines now.
Yes. It is sort of the best of the best. You'll have title holders from other festivals compete against one another. It has its own kind of aesthetic. It tends to lean more towards the classic than as opposed to, like, the neo idea. But it's... Miss Exotic World is,
It's fabulous.
It is fabulous.
And something I want to touch on as well. Now, you mentioned the Mansfield brothers. If I'm not mistaken, and here's another great name, there's also a boylesque company out there. Tell us about that.
I love them. there are a few, actually. And,
oh, really?
If you keep your eyes on Ottawa, something called Bearlesque might be coming.
Bearlesque.
Yeah. But boylesque, there's a group, actually, there's I'm going to go off on a tangent here. There was a group in Seattle called Mod Carousel, and they recently did a parody of the Robin Thicke music video that was so horribly sexist.
Yeah.
And it went viral, and they got about 3 million views, and it's just spectacular. And that was a group of boylesque performers that put that on. So there's them in Seattle, and they're doing wonderful things. And there's pockets of boylesque everywhere. New York City has a boylesque festival. And then Toronto has Boylesque TO, who are spectacular.
They've been visiting for Pride, actually. They'll be on our Pride main stage.
Excellent.
That's awesome.
Ottawa actually has... The Mansfield Brothers they're a vaudeville troupe. So they do comedy skits, they do dancing, things like that. They recently debuted one of their junior members as a boylesque performer just last week. Joseph Mansfield did his first peeling number on stage, and it was spectacular.
Wasn't it to Justin Bieber?
No, that was Audrey Hepburn did a Justin Bieber act. It was to I'll Do Anything for Love.
That's even better.
it was spectacular. Ottawa has historically not had a huge number of male strippers in the boylesque scene.
Mm-hmm.
However, it's growing, and there is increased interest in that.
So they're doing well.
Yeah, as evidenced by the fact that when we bring in boyleskers from other cities to perform, it really packs the house. El Toro is a performer based in Toronto, and when we had him up for the burlesque brunch, which happens third Saturday of every month, he was a great hit with the local crowds, simply because it's a little different.
And he's a heartbreaker. He is.
Oh yes.
And he's so nice, too. One thing we can say about the burlesque community is everyone is so sweet and
very supportive. And
yeah, and the boys are naked, and it's great.
Now, I didn't want to finish off without you just mentioned the burlesque brunch.
Yes.
Tell us about that now.
Once a month, it's the Great Canadian Tees Burlesque Brunch, piloted by a few different local movers and shakers in the scene. And it features a variety of different performers every month, some local, some from out of town. Their tagline is "Come for the bacon, stay for the legs."
Excellent.
And their shows are quite a bit of fun, and it's nice because people who, say, have kids or can't get out to a show at night can come, you know, at noon on a Saturday. And it's very, very casual, hosted by the Mansfields. It's a great opportunity to see burlesque performers, workshop new acts, get to know each other, things like that.
All right. And it happens where?
At Maxwell's.
At Maxwell's. Once a month.
Once a month. Third Saturday of every month. Maxwell's upstairs. Right. Just follow the hootin' and hollerin'.
Is there someplace online where our viewers would be able to get more information on maybe the shows that you guys are putting on or the fundraisers that you're doing?
Mm-hmm. On Facebook, there is a group called the Ottawa Burlesque Playground. It's a great place to keep an eye on all the goings on. There is actually an ongoing document there that will list all the burlesque shows that are happening in the city.
And does Rockalily have a website or?
Rockalilyburlesque.com.
Rockalilyburlesque.com. Mm-hmm. And we can find out more about you two and your group and where you're performing next, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera.
Mm-hmm.
Wow. This was a very eye-opening session.
Yes, definitely. We learned a lot.
Thank you.
Thank you very much, Rhapsody
us.
Blue.
Thanks.
And Helvetica Bold. Thank you very much for being our featured performers this week.
Definitely.
And stand by because we're going to be right back with What's the Buzz? And now, ladies and gentlemen, it's time for What's the Buzz?
Our opportunity to chat with you about all of the things going on in the art scene in Ottawa this week.
That's right, Kitty, because you know, this week it's Pride Week.
That's right.
That's right. In Ottawa, we'll be celebrating Pride, and there are going to be lots of events happening all over the city. So make sure if you have an opportunity, go and visit, because they're a lot of fun. It all starts off with the kickoff, really, to the whole thing is the raising of the rainbow flag, which happens on Monday, August the 19th. And after that, it's followed on Tuesday by the Ottawa Front Runners Pride Run. Now, that's a great fundraising event where all the money goes to some really worthwhile causes. After after that, we have the Scotiabank AIDS Walk, which, again, another great fundraiser. That's the one thing about Pride Day. Not only are they great parties, but they raise a lot of money for some great causes like AIDS research, et cetera, et cetera.
Definitely.
Also, some great fun events. Like, for example, on the Friday night, Friday, August 23rd, they have an event, a dance event called Cirque Bizarre. And this is happening right next to the Centertown Pub, which is on Somerset and Bank. And what they've done is they've converted the whole parking lot into a big dance space. And apparently it's a lot of fun. I can't wait to go. There are going to be a lot of great performers, and it promises to be a real great evening of dancing and entertainment, and a lot of great talent is going to be visible at Cirque Bizarre, and that'll be on the Friday night, August the 23rd. Now, of course, the whole thing culminates with the Pride Parade, which starts at 1 o'clock on Sunday, August 25th, and it starts at Bank and Gladstone, goes all the way down Bank Street, and then turns on to Laurier, and ends up at Marion Dewar Park, where they have a big festival all set up, and there's a beer tent, there's also a main stage with lots of great performers, and there are a lot of booths and places where you can go get vital information. That's all part of the Pride activities.
That sounds like a lot of fun.
Absolutely. So if you have a chance this week, there's no reason to not go out and have a great time on Pride Week.
Definitely. So also going on this week, Odyssey's Theater Under the Stars, they'll be presenting Arms and the Man, which is by George Bernard Shaw. It's a play that demonstrates the hypocrisy in human nature alongside the futility of war, but in a humorous way. It's a comedy. So that's playing in Strathcona Park until August 25th.
That's a great play. Mm-hmm. Really is worthwhile. And out in the park, it's great to be outside watching some great theater.
Definitely.
Now, if you want to be inside, at the Canadian War Museum to August 30th, they're having the World Press Photo Competition. Now, it's billed as, and I quote, the world's most prestigious annual press photography competition. Now, from the write-up and from the research we've done, it's basically a series of award-winning press photos throughout the decade. So it's really something to see if you want to spend some time inside at the Canadian War Museum.
That's great. And when's it going until?
It's going on until August the 30th.
Okay. We've also got English comedian Russell Brand, who will be performing his Messiah Complex tour at the NAC, and that's going to be at 8 p.m. on August 21st.
I love him.
He's quite funny.
He's quite funny. He's really adorable to watch, and he's really, really quite funny and very current. Mm-hmm. He's got that biting British humor, which we
definitely
all love. Now, if you're into family entertainment, something a little quieter with all the festivities and the revelry happening around town, Rideau Hall is having what they call story time. And the way it's billed is bring your kids, pick a book, and enjoy reading at
That's
Rideau
great.
Hall. Yeah, and that goes on until, that goes to August 31st.
Oh, okay.
So a great opportunity to spend time with the family in a nice quiet environment.
Mm-hmm, definitely. Maybe not so much of a quiet environment. We have the Selena Gomez concert.
All right.
That's going to be at the Canadian Tire Place August 22nd. And it's her Stars Dance tour. Things will be kicking off with openers Emblem 3 and Christina Grimey at 7 p.m.
Excellent, excellent. Also another great performer.
Mm-hmm.
Absolutely. And if you haven't seen it yet, make sure you make your way down to the Canadian Aviation and Space Museum, because until September 2nd, you still have a chance to see the Star Wars Identities exhibition.
Right.
With a lot of Star Wars memorabilia, a lot of the posters, a lot of the artwork.
Art, yeah.
Yeah. Have you seen it yet?
I haven't. I have a friend who went, and she had rave reviews about it, said it was amazing. So I'm definitely looking forward to checking it out.
Well, maybe we should go together.
We should.
Absolutely. Absolutely.
Call it a date.
I like that already. So, ladies and gentlemen, that's it for The Buzz for this week. Now, if you have an event... Oh, did I forget something?
We missed the Sparta competition.
We did? I'm sorry. Miss Kitty, please go ahead.
And finally, we also have the Sparta 720-hour film contest that wraps up with the showing of all of the films that have been entered into the contest. That's going to be at the Mayfair Theatre on August 25th from 11:30 until 3. So all of these films are 10 minutes long or less, and they have been filmed within the 30-day time frame that the contest takes place during. There's going to also be some prizes, a general audience cash prize, as well as a 50-50 draw. Tickets are $5 at the door, or you can visit www.72hourfilms.ca for information on advance ticket pricing.
This is a great opportunity to see young filmmakers, local talent,
mm-hmm.
and you know, some great work. But even better, ladies and gentlemen, I understand our very own Miss Kitty is in one of the films. Is that correct?
That is correct. Uh-huh. I am in one of the short films. It's It's a film by John Seed. Uh-huh. It's called Random Encounters. So, yeah, you can come and see my acting skills.
Oh, we get to see you on the big screen.
Yeah, on the big screen.
Well, I look forward to that.
Mm-hmm,
absolutely.
Definitely.
So now I think we're...
Now we're done.
Now,
yes.
Thank you very much. All right, ladies and gentlemen, that brings an end to The Buzz for one more week. And we just want to remind you that if you have an event that you'd like us to promote, please get in touch with us. Just drop us a line at info@mjmepics.com. That's info@mjmepics.com. Please send us the event that you're involved in, and we'd love to feature it on The Buzz. And if you're so inclined, come on in and take part in the podcast, and we'd love to have you on our show.
Definitely. And that's What's the Buzz? Thank you, ladies and gentlemen, for joining us this week on the EP.
Ottawa's Epic Entertainment Podcast.
Don't forget to join us next time for the winner of this week's contest.
That's right. And just a reminder of this week's question, we want to know, who is the author of Confessions of a Mad Drag Queen?
You can send your contest submissions into contest@mjmepics.com.
That's right. The first person to answer the question correctly wins themselves 4 tickets to Confessions of a Mad Drag Queen, happening August 21st to the 24th at Alumni Hall at Ottawa University.
So don't forget to join us, and we'll give you the inside scoop on all of the entertainment business in Ottawa.
That's right. So this is Kitty Kamenyeki.
And this is Denis de la Violette.
Saying thanks you very much, and we will see you next time.